Bad boys, bad boys, what you gonna do? What you gonna do when they come for you? Sing it.
You gotta learn the words, man. You can't get the line on the words.
All right, so in 2003, this was voted the worst film of 2003. The name of the film is Bad Boys 2. I don't remember. I thought I had watched this in the theater, but I believe this was my bachelor pad days. So when during my bachelor pad days, I was pretty much just renting videos. So this was probably an after work, then rented this from my little, we had a nice little place where you could pick a pizza at a tanning salon. It was video. And what else was out there? Oh yeah, you did your laundry. I would rent a video, I'd order a pizza, get my laundry done, pick up the pizza, go rent, you know, watch something like Bad Boys 2 to kind of chillax a little bit from after a hard day's work. And so this is kind of movie I watched, and this is a Jerry Bruckheimer / Michael Bay, the creator of Transformers, came out with this.
The creator of explosions.
Yes, the creator of explosions. And that's one thing, as far as special effects, there's a couple places I will touch on later, but great special effects. Compare this to the chase scene in Matrix 2. This is far better than the chase scene in Matrix 2. Trust me. And when you get that chase scene, and it's probably a little bit better than Road Warrior because we've advanced a little bit. But we'll touch on that a little bit. So Bad Boys 2, we got Bad Boys for Life came out in January, which is the sequel to this. So this is, so because everybody kind of had a, like, what do you call it, a nostalgia for this film. The music is done by Dr. Dre, Sean Puff Daddy Combs. So there's a lot of time stuff of that era was going on. The use of ecstasy back in those days, during the rape days. You don't get to see all that good stuff anymore. Russian mafia, you know, they get exposed a little bit of the Colombian mafia. So a lot of the big stuff that was in 2003 was through that. So we can start off with Lucas and Caleb. Is this your first time watching Bad Boys 2?
It is, and I have not actually seen Bad Boys 1 all the way through.
Yeah.
So, it was kind of, my opinion's kind of
It's my first
skewed.
Bad Boy.
Yeah.
This is my first Bad Boy. I just had to start out by saying, any Will Smith movie is a movie of mine, apparently.
Yeah,
I feel like that's what we've gotten from these reviews, is any Will Smith movie is up my alley at this point, so.
And I'll be honest, when I was younger, when I first, you know, saw it, probably on, like I said, rented on DVD, I enjoyed it. I really did, and, you know, thought it was a little long, but I did enjoy it. And, you know, there's just a lot of things we'll go over with this, and I was trying to, you know, because it was good that I watched it again. It's not so memorable, like where you remember all the lines, but all the lines started coming back to me when I watched it again. We'll go over some of those things. Like, these are your basic household bugs. Which is one of my favorite lines. And one thing, too, is, I was in the preventative medicine field. So I noticed they used a lot of pest control, actually, stuff in the film. And I'll give you some examples. And I noticed that when I first watched it, because if you took, like, entomology, or you took, like, the baker's certification for, looking at restaurants, and all that kind of thing, a lot of that stuff is in there. So when they did the pest control thing, I wonder if they, like, went through, the actors research stuff, because they used a lot of some of that technique in that film, that which is kind of accurate in the pest control field, which was, I thought, was kind of unique. And I'll go over some of that, because I noticed that when I first watched it, you know, when they do the Haitian fight scene, which is one of my favorite shots. Another thing, too, is watching the film reminds me how much of a lazy cameraman I am again, and because I used to love One thing that I loved about these films is that the camera moves. And here they sit there and they criticize Michael Bay and all this stuff, but the camera is always moving. He's giving you that intensity that you're in the moment of the fight. And so how can you criticize that? I mean, that's good. That's good, intense filmmaking. Now everybody does. It's no big deal. But back in 2003, if someone moved the camera, it was like, oh no, they moved the camera. Oh my gosh. That is wild, because people were becoming very, very, very lazy. And, you know, and I get mad at myself. I don't know if you remember when I used to shoot cons, and you'll see me saying, I say, this, you know, blank is getting real. Well, I got that from Bad Boys 2. And I used to take the camera when I get up to cosplayers and I go, shh, and I used to make the sound effects and everything, and go around people, and I'd say, that's my, you know, my Michael Bay shot. I used to call it my Michael Bay shot. Do you remember me saying that? That's where
I remember that. Yeah. I was like, oh.
What does that mean? Yeah, well, that was my Michael Bay shot. And I get around like tier 3 cosplayers and I move the camera around and I go around them like this. I say, this is my Michael Bay shot. Then it got to my ghetto Michael Bay shot, you know. I used different terminology, but that was back in the days when I really cared. But anyways, all right. So, yeah, guys, your reaction. I'm kind of like halfway, because I'll be honest with you, these films are better than Transformers. They really are.
I liked this film. Yeah. I really did. Yeah. There was a lot of a lot of the explosions were definitely overdone. Like,
that's
especially
Michael Bay,
yeah,
for you.
When they were like rolling through the villages, they're like, oh, every one of these little houses is gonna explode.
Every shack explodes.
Yeah, I was like, I don't know. But like, other than that, I really it kept your attention the whole time. It was really entertaining, like
there were so many like logic holes in it though, like so much, like
you mean plot holes? There's some plot holes. I'm sure there is. I mean, here's what I get, because it was kind of hard to, like, I mean, like, Sydney's character, I felt like she was, like, forced in there. You know, it's like, you know, like, they had to have someone in there because, and they had to give her something to do, and they had to have someone looking pretty and all that, and
she's gonna be her sister and the other guy's lover, and she's gonna be the other secret agent on the other guy's side,
right? And I think what I kind of thought they were trying to do is like doing a homage to like cops television shows in the 80s, maybe. I don't know. So, you know, because here's the thing about, if you do an action comedy, you can get away with stupid stuff like that. Because if it was like an action drama, then I would, like, really, really have a problem with it, you know, if I was supposed to take it seriously. But being an action comedy means you can get away with, well, Sydney's character is supposed to be funny, you know, and it's like, it's all right, you know. But she's kind of forced into it, and I got to say, though, the thing that really took me, that I didn't notice, when they're doing the carjacking scene, when they carjack Sydney, say, you can tell that's not Sydney driving. Sydney's not that big. She's not that tall. And every time they do that scene cutaway to her driving, it's like, there's got to be a big grown man driving that vehicle. And you knew it was. That's not that cute little Sydney driving that. But, and like I said, you know, that's the only really big major kind of like action mistake I really, really kind of noticed. Everything else, like I said, the lines were still funny to me. I mean, if you take the comedy, what do you guys think about the comedy aspect?
I thought it was hilarious. I thought a lot of the jokes, like, were definitely of their time, like things you can't say today. But like,
yeah, Martin Lawrence is always good, and if you pair him with Will Smith, it's just like,
well, I can't really say Martin Lawrence is always good. I mean, I'll be honest with you, and
Enrique Spears, he's been bad.
Yeah, there is, because here's the deal, is I'll be honest with you, there was two shows like during that time. There was Fresh Prince, and then there was Martin Show. Oh my god, I can still cannot today watch the Martin Show. And when you take Big Mama's House, I mean, oh no, kill me. Just in my life. Just
I like that one.
Which one? The first one or the second one? The first one's okay, but we get the second one.
We know he's Big Mama.
I mean,
it
I just
have no idea what you're talking about.
Explain what Big Mama is, and probably, and I'll be honest, it probably hurt his career. Be honest with you, when he got to the second one, explain to him what Big Mama is.
Martin Lawrence decides he's going to dress up as this black woman and go undercover.
I've seen this done. Okay,
it's like a reverse White Chicks.
Okay.
Right. And the thing is, Reverse White Chicks, which was terrible. And the worst thing about the White Chicks, you know the reason why White Chicks didn't work out? Because they looked like serial killers wearing people's skin. It was so scary.
That's so true.
And it was...
Together. I like that one. That one is pretty funny.
Yeah. And I'll be honest. I mean, like, Sean and Wayans, he's not bad. I mean, some of his movies are pretty good. Now, Damon's son is getting hilarious. Oh my gosh, his stuff is funny. And I'd like to see more movies with him in it. The movie, have you ever seen the movie Let's Be Cops?
Yeah.
Yes, I thought that was pretty good. I really, really liked that. So let's get into, again, like I said, this is a time capsule. Let's open up 2003. All right, and what do we got in there? We got Sean Combs and Dr. Dre doing the music here, which pretty good music. I got nothing wrong with that. Like I say, Time to Ecstasy, Raves, stuff like that, which you don't really see hardly anymore. Miami Booty, a lot of nice Miami Booty, and that kind of thing was there, very prevalent. Will Smith, to me, was looking his best right here. He was built, he was stylish in all his clothes. I mean, every man wanted to be Will Smith, I think, in this film. And I think every woman wanted to be with Will Smith in this film. He was just great. And good lines and very good, whatever. Martin Lawrence, I tolerate him. Sometimes he's just too... And it's like... And Will can just spot a line without... doing anything. Like, he can say something and it is funny, like, okay, we're gonna take, you know, everything about your ass, we're gonna take everything about my mama's titties, and we're gonna put them in this bag right here, okay? And you just laugh in your ass watching this, and the woman going, y'all need Jesus.
That was so funny. I liked that so much. That was probably one of my favorite parts, like inside of the TV store.
Yeah, I had to come in.
What kind of TV store is this?
Yeah, it just first of all, you get this open shot to Amsterdam, to Miami, which I love. I think is really neat. Dr. Dre, Sean, Puff Daddy Combs have this little nice little thing going on, get your attention. And then you get the drugs delivering in the caskets. And then, of course, we open up with the KKK scene, which is brilliant.
I didn't know what to expect with that being the first scene.
I was like, this is the most disorganized police force.
But, it was like, well, is that how you're going to introduce your characters for the sequel? There you go.
I was like, whenever we were watching the opening, we were like, okay, well, we wonder what we missed from the last movie, what we should know going into this one, because it was a whole lot.
If you watch the first one, it's not gonna help you any.
We were left wondering if it would, though. We were like, I wonder if it would.
Yeah, am I supposed to know these people? I was like, the chief? I feel I should know him better.
Mm-hmm.
Still today, and I'll be honest with you, those opening scenes are very confusing. And because I let me ask you, it took me like 3 times to figure out what the KK members had to do to connect to all this. Do you guys remember?
No clue. It was right after
they were the mules.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, the mules is to kind of, I believe it's to sidetrack from the real dealings. So that's what they pretty much did. And I guess they got paid lots of money for like 2 bags of ecstasy, you know. And so just to throw the police off of the case, and which this, and the thing is that's so terrible about this film. It's, they keep on saying, well, you can't take this guy in. That was their only reasoning why you couldn't arrest the guy, main villain, was because he had gotten 20 people fired in the police. And it was like, okay.
Yeah. Sued a bunch of times in one or something.
Exactly. And that was like, okay, that's what you're going to go with, because it just seems like everything was out in the open. It's like, how is this guy not already in jail? But he didn't. But there you go on that. But, I mean, like I said, I think of the old 80s cop shows. I don't know if you watched any of those. Do you remember the 80s cop shows? You watch any cop shows? Give me an example of a cop show.
Well, literally cops.
Cops.
Be a cop show, I think.
That is okay. Before reality television, you know, there was Dragnet in the 50s and the 60s, and you know, it would kind of like, these are based on real events, and it would try to explain law. And Jack Webb, I think, might have been a real police officer. I don't know. He was like consultant for Hollywood, so they gave him Dragnet. And then I would say during the 70s you had like Starsky and Hutch and all these other flashy things, because you had to make cops cool. So like Starsky and Hutch, we had Huggy Bear, and they go and find out, you know, Huggy Bear, so what's the word on the street, Huggy Bear? And Huggy Bear would tell him what's the word on the street and everything like that. And then the 80s came along, and he had Miami Vice, and that was Crockett and Tubbs. And I think a lot of this, people who did this film kind of based a lot of stuff from like Miami Vice, because a lot of drugs were going in through Miami, which was a big deal. That's the reason why Miami Vice was so popular. Number one, they did, it was kind of like being cops in the MTV generation, and you know, like, because you like Phil Collins' music. Phil Collins actually played a drug dealer in the film, in the TV show, so, and that kind of thing. So it was very popular, and I think a lot of people watched that when they were kids, and they thinking, let's do something to homage to that, and then have like, you know, and then of course you got to have a little Florida elements. But anyways, I kind of give you a basis of what I think ended up being this film, you know, that was put together. I mean, you can go over, there's a lot of overtop looks and wherever have you. Very weak story, a lot of great action, but
yeah, I mean, as far as I'm going, a lot of it didn't really like whenever they were doing this high speed chase, and like, yeah, there was bodies being flung everywhere. Or like whenever they were in another high speed chase and the guy was like, oh, I'll pull this lever and release some of the cars that are on the truck.
These guys are off the chain.
He's like, I don't think it works like this.
Yeah.
But I mean, it was entertaining, and like how he was just like, oh, look at, I found this bag of ecstasy inside of this human, and the other guy's like, oh my god, and like,
ends up taking the ecstasy.
Yep.
Which is drinking it, and like, oh my god, walking around the police chief's house. That was my favorite part.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. It's kind of, when you get to that part, it is kind of like, you know, with me, it was like, okay, kind of cringy a little bit, trying to add a little humor to it. And yeah, I know, it's one of those films like, you know, it's got its good moments, but then it's got its moments of, what were you guys smoking?
Right, yeah.
Because, I mean, it was like, you know, I mean, like, when you get to the, I mean, when you start off with the film, like I said, I love the shot with Amsterdam. I love, you get into the KKK and them shooting him in the butt. You know, things like that. You know, yeah, I'm on board with this film. The fight with the Haitians. Sydney being forced in there kind of loses me. Like I said, her character is kind of like there for, I don't know, for people to look at, and also to give them a little MacGuffin, I guess, of some sort. It just, you know,
drive your two main characters apart.
Yeah, so there you go.
End up together.
True again. That. True that. I never thought of that. So when the writers' room, they were like, "Well, we got to get them to fight over something." I know. Sydney, a woman would do it every time. And so, good. Let's put it in there. And like I said, it is. It's. There's some good things about it. There's some bad things about it. Like I said, the jokes to me, I was laughing. Still today, you know. Like I said, I wrote some of the stuff again that I said. He said, you know, like Will Smith, I just got mad now, or stuff like that.
It had a lot of good lines, like, yeah. A lot of good one-liners that, like, I could see people taking from this movie. And I feel like a lot of movies nowadays don't really have that as much, like, lines, yeah, that'll just punch you and be
memorable.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I mean, the thing is you miss that, I guess, back in the old days, too. And that was another thing. I think they were trying to capture that straight man, funny man thing. Like, you know, Will Smith is supposed to be the straight man, and, you know, Lawrence was supposed to be the funny man type deal. And I think they were trying to play off of that. So I think a lot of things they were just, like, you know, digging up. You know, like, we're like, let's try this, you know, 80s, you know, cop show, you know, the duo man comedy, you know, that kind of thing. But, I mean, then try to put a new twist on it. Like I said, you could feel like it was 2003. I mean, it really, you know, it wasn't, you know, feeling like 70s or 80s. That was 2003, and it felt like 2003. And there's a lot of technology there, though, that it goes a little overboard. Like, I think the police, when they get into the police department, like in the lab area, it's too clean for a lab area. Things like that is overblown, which I get so sick of watching those films and TV shows where they think that, like, everything's going to be, like, spotless, clean, white, light background, and they got these supercomputers. They're doing a Tom Cruise from the Minority Report thing, and you got the girl who's got $10,000 makeup on and who's never seen, you know, she's supposed to be the nerd girl, but she's so sexy, it's not even funny, and she's going, "Well, guys, you need to do this and this and this and this, and everything's going to be this." And you know, they wave in the thing and they try to make it intense. And it's like, yeah, really? Nah. You know, it's like, no, you would have some guy, fat guy with the hot dog hanging out of his mouth on an old beat up computer that needs to be sanitized because he's got his dirty paws on it all the time while he's eating his hot dogs, telling people what's going on. "Well, let me tell you what's going to happen here. We put a surveillance on this part," you know, because nerds are like in the dark, man. They don't care about hygiene. They're just tapping away on the computer, you know. I just get tired of the whole sexy nerd, what do you call it, cliche, which is just cracks me up every time, you know. You know, I'm a nerd, but I'm sexy.
It's such a popular cliche, too.
You know, it's yeah, and it's like when you walk into that lab area and you see that bright lights and everything, like you could eat off the floor. I'm like, yeah. Right, like a bunch of smart people are going to be that clean. Smart people don't give a care. I mean, they'll just pile it, the dirty clothes on the floor. You tell them to get off work, and they're still topping away. What? Get off work? I just hacked into the Washington, D.C. computer program. I'm down with this. More math. Dude, you ever thought about showering? You know how I don't care about showering. Screw that shit. But, you know, that kind of stuff I'm so used to now. It's like I've become numb to it. But anyways, you know, you got those elements that are pretty bad. But like I said, if you get into the comedy, I enjoyed the comedy. I enjoyed the effects. I want to go over a little bit of the storyline because kind of understand why there's a love and hate with me with this movie, because, you know, first of all, we get this, we introduce this Colombian cartel, which is like, how many times has that been done? And then you get
all the time.
The favorite line, though, is his daughter. He's got that daughter, and she says, "Don't I look like a model, Daddy?" And he goes, "Models are filthy creatures." And I'm sitting there dying laughing because I'm thinking, I want to use that line. I'm going to say that to somebody. "Models are such filthy creatures. You look like an angel." "You models are..." You know, and he's not a bad actor. The Russian guy from the Michael Bay films, and he's been to Armageddon and all of them. He always plays the Russian guy. I think he's been in the Transformers movies, you know. And all that, he's in there playing the Russian guy. The pest control thing, I wanted to touch on that because there's a scene when they're fighting the Haitians and they use the mirror thing. And that's something they actually teach people in pest control to do. And when you do injections into corners, is taking a mirror and getting that place. And I thought to myself, I bet you when they were doing the pest control thing, they actually went through some little basic training of pest control. Because, you know, about the rats.
Make it realistic.
Yeah, make it more realistic and thing. These are your basic household bugs. I still wonder, these are your basic household bugs. They walking up the door, and so and then the rats and everything. And like I said, Martin Lawrence sometimes can get on my nerves where he's like Jerry Lewis from the 60s, you know. And you know what I'm talking about. Some of Jerry Lewis is good, but when he goes, "Hey, lady," you got really annoying with the rats and that kind of thing, you know, just rolling your eyes. Oh gosh, like I said, he just... I like him in some films, but, I mean, it's 50-50 with him. It really is. I mean, he just...
Wow, you keep doing that.
Exactly. He does stuff like that. And then Will would say, "What's the matter with your feet?" And Martin be like, "But you hurt my feet." I said, "We're going to stick those feet. We're going to put my mama's titties. We're going to put this mall in a bag right now, all right? That's what we're going to do. And then we're going to..." All right, so we get the Colombia, we get the Russian mafia all together. We got trying to get some ecstasy, and how are these ecstasy delivered? People, tell
us
how
they got the girl in there. How it's
in the bodies?
Yeah, in the bodies, in the coffins.
Right, and it took them how long to figure this one out? And so okay, and so. So we did. That's the issue. We've got to try to stop this ecstasy. That's what our cop's mission is, right? And find out who's behind it, and this guy, all right? So along with it, we get Sydney's character. And guys, explain to me what Sydney is all about. I mean, what's her job in this film? I mean, try to figure this out.
What is she, DEA, I believe?
Yeah, that works.
I gotta get close to him, and like, I don't know, but
collect
it didn't
more
work very
information
well. Yeah, and she was just like, boom, instant damsel in distress.
Yeah, well, I mean, that, and then, like, she's supposed to be DEA, and she plays a, and that's another thing that's overboard. She plays this person covering up as a money launderer. And so she pulls up in a beer truck with all these money counting machines. And it's like, that's what you're like. Because I was like, yeah, right. You got to just, oh, come on. You know, and it's like, and then, you know, and the funny thing is, like, when they got all the money and they got these big old briefcases, you know. And most of the money could be wrapped up in a little bitty pile like that. It's like, that's $200 million, and I want $1 million. And that's where we get the finally fight between the Colombian and the Russian. the Colombian guy was supposed to get $300 million, and then it cost $100 million to launder the $3 million, and he got $200 million back, meaning that the Colombian guy was going to be short $100 million. So now he was mad at the Russian, and he's going to go after the Russian guy's family, which makes him mad, and he goes after the Colombian guy. So now they're at odds at each other, and which is interesting, really interesting. And this is where the you get into this part of the meat of the film. Like, you got the bread, which is okay. The bread's kind of sweet. It's kind of nice. Then getting the meat of the film, it's kind of like, boom, boom, boom. Oh, Sydney. The Russian guy. You're just like, that plot is really making it hard to swallow the sandwich. But like at the start, man, I mean, we're just, that introduction is great. I love the battle with the Haitians. Like, he had the ice. Yeah, sure, go ahead. Explain who Ice Pick is and all that.
I was kind of confused about that.
Yeah, that was the rat, you know, and everything is like, you got to have the mule, you got to have the rat. So Ice Pick is the rat, right? That's his.
I thought treat him unfairly.
Snitch was treated unfairly?
I thought so. Like, he was trying to help him out, and he wanted to make a little moolah for it. They broke his shop all up, and I remember thinking,
yeah,
they're assholes.
Yeah, that's supposed to be comedy, though. And that, too, again, like I said, we're practicing a dance for the police or something. I can't, remember that. And that was supposed to be, okay, so now we're back out of action to comedy again. And so the snitch, of course, when you get to the Haitians are like so mean. And so I think these guys want to kill them, you know?
The Haitians could barely speak. I don't know, like, who wrote their line.
I think that's the Haitians, because you got Haitians, I guess, because they're so close to Florida, right? And you think of the Jamaicans in New York, you know, because there's a big Jamaican community in New York. And, you know, like David Chappelle said, you know, I don't even smoke with the Jamaicans, because it's when by the time they get it, it's no longer weed anymore. And because it isn't. And it's like, with the Haitians, it's kind of like that kind of culture in some ways, if it's in Miami, because there's probably not a large Jamaican community, but there's probably more of a Haitian community, which is, I don't know. I'll be honest with you guys. I mean, I know there's got to be a lot of diversity in Miami as far as how it's divided up. The only thing culture I don't see a lot in Miami is Asian culture, but...
It was also in 2003, so...
Well, let's go over the culture you got going on here. You got Haitians, you got Colombians, you got Cubans, you got Haitians. We already said Haitians. You got Will Smith and Martin Lawrence. Probably one of the funnier scenes of the film is the boy wanting to pick up the daughter, which is my favorite scene. Let's talk about that scene. I swear, if I had a kid, and that's why my bud would be like, you know, someone would walk in, I'm here to pick up your daughter. How old are you? I'm 15.
You gotta be at least 30.
At least 30.
And then the friend comes in and says the exact same thing, and just like, oh my gosh.
I love when Will comes out there with a big old, I don't even know, it looked like wine. It doesn't even look like a 40. And he's like holding that thing, and he pulls out the gun. He said, I ain't going back to jail. That was like one of my favorite. And like I said, when you get routines like that, you know, it kind of just relieves the you know, the silliness of the film. See, that's the whole thing about, like, Big Mama 2. It doesn't have that. You know, it's just... And one thing, here's what the big thing about Big Mama 2 is, like, it was like, okay, kids really like Big Mama 1, so you're going to have to tone down the cussing and the nudity and all that kind of thing for Big Mama 2, right? So it just made it even worse than Big Mama 1. And like I said, you don't have that, you know, where it was like... I think one thing about what this film does, I think what they were trying to do is, like, a lot of action, then let's take a comedy break. Action, comedy break, action, comedy break. So, getting through this film, you know, we finally get to this mortuary, where is the big scene. So, this is the big reveal. So, guys, have at this, the big reveal at the mortuary.
When they first discover that, oh, hey, there's stuff in these bodies.
Yeah, which took them a long time to figure out.
Yeah, a long time. Took Lawrence a long time to even look or touch the bodies, like...
Yeah, I like that he ended up getting trapped, like, under the sheet with one of them, and I was like, oh, man, like, sometimes movies give me, like, a little bit of anxiety that's like, ooh, is he gonna get caught, you know, and I was like, that was one of those times where I was like, ooh, he's there, man, like, I don't know.
On the big boobies?
Yeah. That was a great scene, though, especially since, you know, they throw the axe in, ends up going in the cup, and he drinks the water, and it's in there, and then going to the captain's house. That was my favorite scene, was
all that.
That one was going to the captain's house. Yeah, and walking around and walking up the stairs, and, like...
You could relate to that scene.
I couldn't believe it. I was like, oh, my God.
So, and I'm kind of confused, because now... Because they had to release the Florida, one of the guys, the KKK guys, for to get to the Dixie 7. Was that after the mortuary or before the mortuary?
After.
Okay, so how did we get there when they, because I was trying to...
I don't know how we got there. I think they were like, you know what, let's grab this guy.
Yeah.
And like, the directors were like, let's grab this guy, and then...
Take him hostage?
Yeah, I don't know. It was weird. I feel like it didn't even belong
in
a thing in their team of whatever, but I mean...
It was a little bit funny. I think I liked that part better than kind of the mortuary scene, because that's when... Oh, no. That's when they kind of, like, divided. No, you know what? Take it back. The Dixie 7 thing came first, because, you know... And the thing is that hurts the film is, like, justification for them to do all this illegal wiretapping.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's kind of like, why, you know? And I wonder about Michael Bay's, like, political views, if he kind of is pro, like, you know, wiretapping and, you know, breaking the law and stuff, because it's like, because even police officers have to follow the law, you know? And
yeah,
and then... Yeah, I mean, the whole thing that kills me is they go through all this illegal wiretapping, right? And everything. And then at the end, when they get to the mortuary scene, they want a warrant.
Yeah. That was weird. I don't know, man.
I think, here's what I think, and I may be wrong, but I think there was, like, a scene deleted. Or they should have, like, made it more personal about Sid, because they could have justified all that stuff, illegal wiretapping and all that stuff, by putting Sid as being an emotional character and say, well, that's the motivation for them to do all this stuff. But there really wasn't much motivation for them to, like, do that stuff until Sid gets involved. Then it's like, okay, that's motivation for you to do all that stuff that you're not supposed to do. Like, when you get those films where people do revenge, you know, and all that kind of thing, in the cop film, you know, like, they throw their badge down.
I kidnapped her, but she was, like, totally fine the whole time.
Yeah.
And, like, it wasn't really much. Yeah, it was just like, by the way, she's now in Colombia or wherever. or Mexico, and it was like, okay, well.
Yeah, and that's what makes me, that what's made me so mad when I first watched the film was like, okay, they do the big bust, right? And they're all excited. And then Sydney's kidnapped. And you're like, man, I thought this was over. And it was like, and it's like, now Sydney's kidnapped. And it's like, why are you adding 30 minutes to this film, you know, that you don't need? But yeah, they do. And, you know, and those action scenes, grant me, are great. And that climax is really great. But it's like, somewhere around the way, you could cut something out to make it a little bit tolerable, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I feel like there should have been a little bit more of a reason for everyone to go
to Colombia.
Yeah, yeah, instead of just like, oh, let's go get your sister.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There should have been some more emotional things. See, that's the thing that hurts with her being a DEA agent, because it's like, that's your freaking job.
Yeah, it's like, you know, she was a little stronger than just damsel in distress.
Yeah, exactly, because it really,
to play her as.
Yeah, it kind of hurts the, you know, the DEA. Of course, I watched Con Air not too long ago, and there's not really much good to say about the DEA in that film, but this one is kind of like, I don't know. That's what I'm saying. I wonder if Michael Bay is, like, all for the drug war and all that kind of politically, because I mean, it's kind of, that's what's so stupid about the drug war, and I hate being political, but you're killing people for drugs. I mean, that's what's stupid. It's like, what's the real outcome? Okay, so this guy is like pumping himself through opium, heroin, or marijuana, or whatever, and you're killing 10,000 people to stop a dude from snorting cocaine. It's like, I mean that's what's so screwed up about the whole drug war, and I hate to say that, but it's the truth. I mean, it's like, you know, you sit there, you look at the drug war, it's like, oh yeah, we killed 10,000 people today, so some dude in Miami wasn't snorting cocaine.
Great, what an awesome
trade-off. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. There is, like, yeah, and that's the reason why it's, I mean, I can understand, but it's the truth. I mean, that's what the drug war really is, and that's the reason why, you know, you get Sydney in there, and you're like, is Michael Bay all for this stuff, or what? You know, I don't know. I mean, it's like, it's crazy to me. I just, like, you know, and all the stuff that she does just to get this guy caught, you know, so he can't.
It was weird. It was definitely like, I felt like there was a lot missing with that character, or yeah, that character should have been split into a few different characters or yeah, something. It was just weird about it.
Well, they didn't even end up together in the end.
Yeah, no, they didn't.
So.
Really? Well, I mean, yeah, that's what I'm saying. All it is the pull scene, in which is the same gag they do again.
Yeah, two times.
Yeah, and stuff like that, and everything. I just, you know, it's one of those things. It's just like, and like I said, and then now they got nostalgia for it, so they're going to make a new one. Nor they made a new one, which came out in January, and you guys haven't seen that one either, have you? Mm-mm. For that one. So, all right, so that's Bad Boys 2. Well, let's get into the big climax ending scene. So we're following Sydney all the way to
Colombia,
and let's
place that isn't America, but it's on the border.
let's talk about Colombia.
Big house, beautiful house. They basically are like, okay, we're gonna go kidnap my sister back, and then like there was like this part of the police force that were like, all right, bro, we're ready.
We're in.
Yeah, like we're ready, and they're it just I feel like it should have been a little more orchestrated rather than just like everyone being like, let's do this.
It was a free for all.
Yeah, it was really weird, but I mean they got there. There's a lot of. There's another chase scene that I really liked, the one where they like end up on the border, which was pretty cool. I haven't seen that done potentially. I don't know, but like I enjoyed it.
Yeah, the action scene, like I said, I enjoyed. Let me get this straight. Like I said, I'm not all crazy about the motivation, because the motivation is kind of like, what were you smoking? And, you know, it's like you go through that, but when you get to the action through the whole thing, it's like brilliant. I mean, great chase scene, this intense mine in the sand scene.
Yeah, the action was amazing and really kept your attention, which was really great.
And it's like with me, that's
pretty late at night and, you know, kept our attention.
I mean, it's like what we were talking about, like modeling and photography. You know, that's kind of visuals I look at. And I think this is something I would do visually because you don't have to worry about a storyline, right? But the problem is with a movie, they kind of want you to have a motivation for all this. And that's what's sad. But I love the little robot coming up there and blowing up. The little, what is it?
Like, I can't,
yeah. Is that cool? That was cool. I like that. I love the, you know, then they jump, pop up with the bazooka and shoot the security thing out. It was pretty cool. And then they go running and get Sydney and all this. And
iguanas to, like, trigger the alarms.
That was pretty cool. The iguanas and cats. And I love the little girl comes in there and goes, "Daddy, can I keep them?" "No." And that was the first thing. The line is so great, too. So we're going to use the iguanas and cats to...
I'm all the way over here.
Everyone use the iguanas and cats to set off the motion sensors. And the first thing that's going through my mind is like, iguanas and cats?
I know, that was really weird. But I mean, I guess I get it.
I think, personally, I think it was there for humor. I think it was somebody sitting there writing at the typewriter or, you know, our computer nowadays and saying, they're just thinking iguana and cats. And someone's just laughing. He said, that would be funny. Just say iguana and cats. Just saying it is just funny. And it's like, then the little girl with the cat goes, "Daddy, can I keep him?" But it was like iguana and cats. And we were throwing the iguanas and cats over the fence. You're just imagining that. It's like two of the different type of animals you just don't think about. You know, you just don't go there. It's like, let's go get some iguanas and a cat.
Yeah, trip up the alarm system so we'll turn them off and we can storm the place. Sounds good.
Iguana and cats. So we steal the Humvee. We bust through the house. We got a nice huge chase scene, knocking over huts. Just happened to be making cocaine. I guess they thought that everybody in Cuba just sits around making cocaine. I don't know.
Yeah.
I guess that's the only reason for all the explosions.
Yep.
But it was like, that was one. Oh, and we're passing by a cocaine lab. And they knew it was a cocaine lab, too. That was the funny thing about it. It was like the guy, "Oh, I know Cuba, and I know a cocaine lab when I see one." And so they go in there, and they just knock down a cocaine lab just for fun. And then the soldiers from Cuban soldiers are following them, and they get to the Guantanamo Bay before all the negative press for Guantanamo Bay, which would come out like 2 years later. And so they get there, and they have to get through the minefield, and it's a very intense scene. Wonderful effects. I really, you know, even though people probably think they're kind of cheesy nowadays, but it was enough to keep you in the moment and make you feel intense. And it's like, it's a shame that there wasn't, you know, better motivation, but hey, you know. And then we get to the end where Will and Martin are on the float in the swimming pool, and we get the pool gag again.
Same pool gag. Same way. Nothing new.
They spent money on two pools for this film.
Yeah.
All right, so let's start off trying to think if we should do what we like or what we didn't like, because we kind of got that out of the way. Okay, we've said this before. How would we make this film better?
Two Will Smiths.
Yeah, add another Will Smith.
Bad Boys 3.
I guess solidifying Sydney's character and who she's actually supposed to be and what she's supposed to be doing. That's my thing. Or take her out, I guess. I feel like there should have been another character there, though. Someone kind of important.
Like I said, you know what I would have done probably? Maybe have someone like Sydney die.
Yeah.
And that would give them a little bit more motivation to do what they did. Like, they could say, well, if your cousin who was in the DA had died, wouldn't you have done the same thing or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
That might have made it a little bit, because other than that, you're scratching your head going, why are they doing all this illegal wiretapping? And this guy's done enough crime. I mean, he chopped a dude up. Isn't that enough to send him to jail? I mean, they gave. I mean, you got a severed thumb. You have that's. You remember what is motivation? What is the Latin term for it? Which means you have to have a body. With a body, you have evidence. Without a body, you have no evidence. Right. So you cannot take someone to prison. They have a thumb. That's enough to incriminate someone. So I'm.
Yeah, I guess it would just take too long that way.
Yeah, they already had Sydney or something like that, I guess. They were like, well, we need to go now.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying is, if what I would have done is here, if I rewrote the film, I'd gone back and maybe have Sydney in there, but what I would do, she'd be at the beginning, and she'd be laundering money for the big dude and everything, and they kill her. Like, just... she gets killed, and you find out that Will Smith had an affair with her in New York. You find out that she's related to Martin Lawrence. They find out for the first time that she is DEA, and it really makes them mad as all get out to want to go after this guy. So they're rogue now, and they really want to do everything in the world to capture him. That's the motivation.
Mm-hmm.
With her being alive, and then like, oh, Sydney, be careful. Be careful, Sydney. This guy's a killer. I know.
Especially when they don't even end up together. Like,
yeah.
Very irrelevant.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If she was killed, and, you know, then I think that would have, you know, like, and you could have established their characters a little bit where there's a little emotional, because you got to have that little emotional setting, and then kill her. So, you know, like the Mad Max dog, then you got, you know, some motivation there. There you go. I'm done with that. Y'all want to touch anything a little bit else on that? Music-wise, what do you guys think about the music for 2003?
It was very 2003. That's all I really have to say about it, honestly.
Yeah, well, y'all little kids listen to that.
I was really young in 2003, so...
I mean, they bring back any memories, like...
I guess, like, the vibe, maybe, at least for, like, movies made in that time.
Nothing music-wise. Well,
not specific.
What was on the... Okay, 2003, what was on the iPod?
Oh.
I was, like, 6. I didn't have an iPod. I was really young.
What was on the iPod, Caleb?
Oh, man. I'm trying to think for the life of me, but I think I was too young.
Nobody had an iPod when they were 6? Y'all were like depraved and deprived.
I had action figures.
I had a cell phone like almost in high school. I think I had like a flip phone in middle school, my very last year of middle school maybe. Yeah. But like,
Music was so... See, that's what I'm saying. You know, music was so important to me when I was a kid. I mean, I started writing music when I was probably 6, and I was being taught by a piano teacher. She was like one of these Philadelphia harmonic, you know, that kind of stuff, and you do all that. And so I was surrounded by music all the time, and I was like practicing all day. And like, so I started writing music, and so music was very important when I was younger. And like I said, the 80s too was really big to me. My favorite band, 6, it was Duran Duran. I always wanted to be Simon Le Bon. I really did. And that music is what changed my taste of music. And that's what made me want to, you know, write music, because they were very techno and progressive. And that's what I like, you know, those days. And so, like, you know, listening to this was neat to go back, you know. And I noticed a lot of that DMX feel. You know, it was like, y'all remember DMX? Mm-hmm. Up in here. Well, I'm going to lose my mind up in here. You know, I always loved that voice, that deep voice. It's like... And I think after that, then he had a movie that he did where he was like, doing some revenge thing. But, you know, he was all right. But he always had that voice, it was real deep, you know. It was like, and I miss that stuff, man. I really do. It was like very exciting, very party. Rave stuff was cool back in those days. You know, you used to, they have like those places in between, like Murray and the, you know, you had the college, which was like totally dry, and then you had to go like in between there, between where the, you know, the city was, and in between the and you get like one of them old meat factories, and then you turn it in and you get a DJ, and then that became the rave, and you know, and all that, you know, it was a closed down like meat factories and stuff like that. And those are your rave places and hangouts, you know, and all that stuff. And, you know, you were experimenting with different beats and all kinds of stuff like that. The computer age was coming in there. So it was like, you know, like you used to drop the bubbles from the ceiling and all that crap. Oh, man. You know, those days are gone now. You ain't got none of that stuff now. Everybody's scared to death out there now. I'm afraid of touching something. I may get a disease. Last night, that's what we did last night. We were like, screw this coronavirus. We did a lot of stuff that we shouldn't did out of rebellion, because it was like so mad, because everybody's like so scared. And that's the reason why I called Kiddo up. I was like, hey, let's do videos, because at first I was going to take a break because of all this, but I was like, you know what people are going to do? They're going to watch videos.
Mm-hmm. Because that's what everyone's doing right now. I should be posting on Instagram, but exactly. I have nothing to post.
Yeah, and I'm mad about that. I really am mad about it. I wish I could see you, but you know, like I said, I need to call Monday and see if we can switch my Evansville ride to St. Louis, and we'll try that. I've got Monday, you know, scheduled off so I can like, you know, spend more time, but. Yeah, man, last night, I really got back into vibe last night, bro. I mean, I had the smoke machine going, and the purple lights, green lights going. You know, we were having a blast. And, you know, come up with some creative stuff. And I'm like, man, I got to get back in there. And it's like, so we'll see. We'll go over the modeling stuff after this. So, guys... Bad Boys 2, would you recommend it to a friend?
I definitely would, yeah. It was interesting enough.
And I might go back and finish the first one. I might not gain anything from it, but...
Maybe we'll watch the new one.
Yeah, I think you guys should. And that was one of the reasons I kind of wanted to do it, to kind of prepare you for the new one, if you wanted to go that route. And that kind of thing. And like I said, to me, I think it's one of Will Smith's best performances. I'll be honest, Will, I'll give him a 10. I'll give Martin a 5. Anybody else, he's like, other than that, I just, you know, whatever. You know, you can keep, it's like, you could put anybody else in that movie. Yeah. But it's like, Will, that was when Will became a superstar. You know, that was during the time when, I mean, he had Independence Day. He had that one, the Bad Boys film. He became an international success. So, you guys, voted worst film of 2003. Check it out. We're going to try to have this up by Monday night so you can watch it. Peace. We're out here. I'm going to talk. business with the Boogie Brothers here and get this going, all right?
Oh, that's funny. That's bad.
Who's your daddy?